Well, last week we spent a little bit of time talking about spiritual growth. And the thing about spiritual growth is it comes when you put it into practice. So you can spend a lot of times reading about parenting or raising children, but until you actually start doing it, it doesn't do you a whole lot of good. It's kind of like, I would imagine a lot of you have been sitting around watching Netflix, baking shows, and after a while you think, that looks good, I'm gonna make some of those myself. So you go, and after hours of spending all this time watching people bake cookies, you are now baking cookies, but you burn them. Because you've never really baked cookies before. And so, simply having some knowledge of watching something on TV or reading something doesn't translate into life habit and into actual skills. Into real growth. It's important for us to take spiritual truths, things that the Bible says, and then begin to practice them, to do them in real life, to turn them into habits and to lifestyle. If you're anything like me, though, you spend most of your time just sort of putting around in life and just enjoying one day to the next until a crisis hits. And then suddenly you realize you've got the spiritual strength of a 2-year-old and your muscles have just never really been used. We find ourselves right now being impatient, angry, discouraged, frustrated, fearful. But this should be the time that Christians shine. So a good question to ask ourselves is, do I feel like I'm shining or do I feel like I'm dull or fading? Now, this doesn't mean that we don't lament, right? We don't suddenly become non-human with no emotions. We still lament. If you've lost your job, you should grieve over that. The book of Lamentations, which we're going to look at a little bit here today, sympathizes with you if you're going through stuff right now. But even in the midst, the question is your hope penetrating through the dullness? And is it shining? Because as Christians, that's what we should be doing. But the book of Lamentations, you see throughout all of the heartbreak, it's this big lament over the destruction of the city of Jerusalem. Even in the midst of all the heartbreak, there is a light shining through of hope. In chapter 3, verses 21 through 26, it says, "Yet I call this to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's faithful love, we do not perish, for his mercies never end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say, the Lord is my portion. Therefore, I will put my hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the person who seeks him. It is good to wait quietly for salvation from the Lord." There are three things that I think we need to learn and put into practice from this passage during this time of quarantine. The first is to learn and practice hope. Lamentations 3, 21 through 23. "Yet I call this to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's faithful love, we do not perish, for his mercies never end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness." We have to learn where our source of hope lies. It should lie in God's faithfulness, in his love, in his mercy. And realize that God is not unaware of our situations. Now, most people, they put their hope into other people, right? It's hope in a government run by a bunch of people, in certain politicians. Your hope is that your boss will give you that raise because he saw how hard you've been working. I'm hoping that someone else out there is going to give me a better life. Maybe that's a spouse or some sort of relationship you've been pursuing, and you're just hoping, if I just meet the right person, then everything will be okay. A lot of people try to glean their self-worth or their value from others. Whether it's seeking personal approval, seeking love, seeking validation, all these different things that we're hoping to get from other people. But what happens when you're suddenly quarantined from all of these people that you used to hope in? Or worse, you're quarantined with those people and you suddenly discover they drive you nuts and you can't get away from them, and you didn't realize I'm horrible and they've got some horrible things too. And normally we get to go out into the world and spill our horribleness onto other people all throughout the day and then come home and there's not as much to spill onto each other. But now we're just at home oozing our horribleness onto one another all day long. What do you do? And suddenly you discover, ooh, it's really hard to love someone the way God has called me to love them when they have been the center of my hope. And you realize that they are not what you hoped they would be. Another thing we put hope into is money. Money can get you all sorts of stuff, right? Power, pleasure, prestige, the security from the fear of the unknown, what happens in the future. Don't know what's going to happen, but if I have enough money, I can get through it. But what happens when the economy starts to suffer? What happens when you're not sure if your job is going to be around in the next year because that industry is getting hit hard? What happens when your investments maybe start to dry up? So we have to learn that God has new mercies for us every day. This is such a great thing to realize, because going through hard times, we discover all of these false idols that we have placed our hope in. And so we need to come to God and confess that and say, I need mercy, because I've been living my life putting hope in things that my hope should not have ultimately been in them or it. So right now, during the quarantine, we have the opportunity to practice hope, and specifically practice hope in the Lord. So here's a couple things you might do. Each morning, this week, when you wake up, Monday morning happens. Wake up, Lord, I confess that I've put my hope into all sorts of things when it should have been in you. Help me today to put my hope in you for everything that I need today. Praise him for his faithfulness. Praise him for his love. Now, this practice of hope, it necessitates our second thing that we need to learn and practice, which is that we need to learn and practice dependence. Lamentations 3:24 says, I say, the Lord is my portion, therefore I will put my hope in him. So we have to learn where our true dependence actually lies. It's in the Lord. It's not ultimately in an economy or a government or a job or other people. Ultimately, now again, this doesn't mean that, you know, God doesn't use all these people, but ultimately, it's through the Lord. I love this word portion that it says. It says, I say the Lord is my portion. A portion is what? It's a part. It's a ration. I think of Thanksgiving. You just had this big old meal and they set down the pie and they cut it into portions so that everybody gets their piece. I've never experienced a Thanksgiving where they just did one slice down the middle and we're just feeding two people. and the rest of you can just suck it up. You had plenty of turkey already. That's not a thing. You get your portion. And how much better when that portion is coming from the Lord. Some translations, instead of portions, will say inheritance. This is also a great realization. Like, wait a minute, I have an inheritance from the Lord. As a Christian, I already have the keys to heaven because I am a child of God. I've been adopted into his family. So I've already got everything I could ever hope for. It's just not here yet. But God is the source of our happiness and our blessings. The Lord is my portion. In other words, the Lord is everything I need. He's going to provide all of my needs. Physically, emotionally, mentally, spiritually, relationally. The Lord is all I need. And I don't have to feel jealousy or envy of others when it looks like they're getting a bigger portion of something. It's not fair that they're still employed during all this. It's not fair that they have a great family they're hanging out with and I'm stuck with my family or whatever things that go through our head. We don't have to feel that envy or jealousy because God is going to give you exactly what you need. And maybe you're in that situation where you're going, I'm not really happy with the relationships around me right now. Well, the Lord will give you the strength to learn to love them the way they need to be loved. He'll give you what you need. It's something that we have to learn and then put into practice. So we have the opportunity right now to practice dependence on God. So maybe this looks like sitting down to a meal. And when you pray, hey, here's a legit prayer to you, God. Thank you that you have provided this meal. I know I went to work and I got a paycheck and then I went to the store and I made the meal and here, but no, I'm recognizing this is from you, God. This is from you. Maybe it's when you go on a walk this week. And as you're walking down the street, instead of just doing the regular ho-hum thing, you're thinking as you walk, Lord, these trees, thank you for the shade that you provide from them. And then you notice, man, the sun's really beating down and it's so beautiful out. Thank you for the warmth that you've given us through the sun. You see the mailman coming along. Lord, thank you for that mailman that brings me my check every month. You see a cat run by and you go, thank you, Lord, that I don't own a cat. Or maybe that you do own a cat. Please don't send me any hate mail. Right? Maybe it's giving generously because you realize the Lord is going to fill me up with what I need. How can you put this into practice? So both hope and dependence, they seem to take forever, right? That's the hard thing about them. They take forever. So this brings us to our final thing that we need to learn and practice, and that is patience. Lamentations 3, 25 through 26. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the person who seeks him. It is good to wait quietly for salvation from the Lord. We have to learn patience because waiting is hard. It's frustrating. But the thing is, waiting exposes how lacking we are in those first two areas of hope and dependence. We find ourselves getting irritated and angry. And in fact, I would dare say that most anger, it's really fed from impatience. It feeds off, it grows from our impatience. It's not too many of us that are just angry for no reason. It's I'm getting tired of something. Why is this taking so long? And it just happens again and again. And that anger builds and builds. Some of the cruelest words that we say, it's a result of impatience. Think about that thing that you said to that person that was just taking too long at that light. And you're like, seriously, do you know where your gas pedal is? And you just get so frustrated and you finally drive by them. You had some choice words you yelled out the window. Hopefully not. But yeah. Maybe it's the words you said to that person at work or at church that, you know, was taking that position that you wanted. Maybe it's the thing you said to the person in front of you at the checkout lane because they were taking forever. Like, do you really need to pay in pennies? Come on. Maybe it's the children that you are trying to teach math to right now and they just don't get it. And you're going, come on, it's not that hard. Or maybe they're just asking too many questions. You're becoming impatient. Maybe it's the spouse that you just can't figure out why they take so long to get ready. Every movie they're late for. It's like, we're going to the movies and you're late. How are you still late? The movie's literally in our living room now. It's 15 steps away and you're still late for the movie. And you just become more and more irritated. I think likewise, some of the most hurtful things that we have done or said to God come from our impatience. Think about some examples from the Bible for a minute. Abraham, he gets tired of God delaying and giving him a child through his wife, so he goes and finds another girl to have a child through. You look at the Israelites, God delivers them from slavery in Egypt, and now they're sitting around waiting for Moses to come down off the mountain, and they get tired of waiting, so they make themselves an idol and claim that it is what brought them out of Egypt. You look at King Saul, who, waiting to go into battle, he's waiting for Samuel to come, God's prophet, to come and offer the sacrifice and offering before the battle. And he's waiting and he's waiting and he gets impatient, so he just does it himself. But he disobeys God's command. In every single one of these situations, there were serious consequences. Things did not end up well as a result of simple impatience. Now, in some of those cases, I would have gotten impatient too. So like King Saul waited days. Like, I'm supposed to be going into battle. My people are leaving. You know, my soldiers are wandering off. What do I do? Is he coming? I don't know. I can't text him, find out where he's at. Maybe he got, you know, a heart attack on the side of the road and he's just never showing up. But so many times we get impatient with God. He's just taking too long. I'm going to do this myself. Patience becomes even harder during trying times. Our impatience grows, and we start to do things out of our own will instead of God's. And so we need to recognize, it's very important for us to recognize that God is working in our midst. I love what the prophet Habakkuk illustrates at this point in chapter 3, verses 17 through 19. He says, though the fig tree does not bud and there is no fruit on the vines, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no food, though the flocks disappear from the pen and there are no herds in the stalls, yet I will celebrate in the Lord. I will rejoice in the God of my salvation. The Lord, my Lord, is my strength. He makes my feet like those of a deer and enables me to walk on mountain heights. Even if nothing seems like it's going your way, and all the things that you're doing are failing, know that in due time, the Lord's time, He will supply all of your needs. So right now, we have the opportunity to practice patience. So when your internet connection is going in and out while you're trying to have your video conference, take a breath. Thank the Lord that you have this crazy technology that you can even have this conversation. And ask the Lord to get you that connection working again. Ask Him for patience as you call up the Comcast or AT&T person and you have to have that frustrating conversation. Say, Lord, help me to empathize with this poor person that I'm talking to that has to deal with people like me all day that are frustrated out of their minds. Maybe when you're frustrated homeschooling the kids with the grandkids or your kids and you're just, I can't do this anymore. Stop and thank the Lord for their real teachers. Ask the Lord to bless them, to give them a raise. Ask for the Lord to give you patience as you work with the kids. Perhaps when you're wondering when we can all go back to church in person. Well, that's the time where we thank the Lord that this is temporary, that we actually do get to go back in person at some point. Ask the Lord to bless and protect those churches and countries where that's not an option, where a public gathering is not something they can do. And so recognize that the Lord has provided so much. And I need to be patient while I'm waiting for Him to provide whatever else it is I think I need. So at the end of the day, when you're laying down to bed, take a moment and confess those things to the Lord. Lord, I'm sorry that I lost my patience with the kids. Lord, I'm sorry that I lost my patience with the Comcast guy. Lord, I'm sorry that I lost my patience while I was trying to get dinner ready and people weren't paying attention when I was asking them to set the table and whatever it was. Lord, I'm sorry. Will you help me tomorrow to grow in my patience with you and with others? So even as we lament the loss of our normal life, for now, let's seize the opportunity to grow in these areas, to deepen our spiritual lives, and trust that as we do this, the Lord is going to bless us in our physical lives with the patience we need, with the discernment for what direction to go with my job or my investments or whatever it might be. And may the Lord bless you and strengthen you. May He build you up with hope in His faithful love. Would you pray with me? Father God, thank you so much. Thank you so much for your faithful love. And the knowledge that we have that you will carry us through all these things. Lord, I just pray as I've been doing for a while that you would help our country. You'd help the whole world. But Lord, we pray for specifically our country, for our government officials, for those that are trying to help our economy, help our health and our well-being. Lord, we pray that you give them wisdom, help them to work in unison. Lord, we pray that you would just melt away divisions and help us to have unity in our country. Lord, for those of us sitting at home yet another week, I ask for patience. I ask for patience, knowing that you're going to make all things right in your time. Lord, I pray that we would realize our true dependence on you, and that as we realize that you are really the provider of all things, that we would be men and women of hope, and that we would feel the hope of your faithful love and your mercies for us every day. So we pray in your name, Jesus. Amen. Have a good morning, everybody.